Good evening, everyone. I, Dr. Satyen Raghuvanshi, welcome you all to today's Prayas webinar. We are starting with basic physics and radiology, and this is the part one of our basic physics and radiology. It is a very difficult, but it is a must-know topic for all the residents. Today on board, we have Dr. Eesha Rajput, who is a keen academician. Dr. Eesha is an alumnus from the prestigious Armed Forces Medical College, Pune, and she has been my batchmate in the college. She is a gold medalist in most of the subjects in MBBS. And Dr. Eesha has also written a book which she will introduce to you. Dr. Eesha, you are good to go?
Yes. A very good evening to all the participants who have joined us already. And I'll be welcoming for those who will join later. I thank Dr. Satyen for making me a part of Prayas Radiology and Resident Education. The topic for today's lecture is production of X-rays. The objectives of this lecture are to give the residents a brief overview of the history of X-rays, to describe in detail the components of X-ray tube, to describe the process of X-ray generation and factors that affect the quality of X-rays. To start with part one, which is the history of X-rays. In 1901, for the first time in history of physics, Nobel Prize was awarded to Professor W.C. Roentgen for the discovery of X-rays. Today, we have just completed the Human Genome Project. This happened just because Watson and Crick had proposed the double helical structure of DNA in 1953 using X-rays. Many proteins like hemoglobin, myoglobin, and crystals known today are discovered by X-ray crystallography. X-rays, without which we would not have enjoyed studying this specialty of ours, has developed from this discovery only. More than 100 years later, after the discovery of X-rays, these rays have still not lost their glory and importance, either in the field of medical imaging or in non-medical studies. Roentgen was interested in cathode rays and in assessing their range outside of the charged tubes. The discoveries of X-rays in 1895 was the beginning of a revolutionary change in our understanding of this physical world. Now we will see the story of how W.C. Roentgen discovered X-rays. In the winter of the year of his 50th birthday and the year following his appointment to the leadership of University of Würzburg, Rector Wilhelm Conrad Roentgen noticed a barium platinocyanide screen fluorescing in his laboratory as he generated cathode rays in a Crookes tube some distance away. Leaving aside for a time his duties to the university and teaching his students, Rector Roentgen spent the next 6 weeks in his laboratory working alone, not talking to anybody, not sharing anything with his colleagues. And 3 days before Christmas, he brought his wife into his laboratory and they photographed the bones of her hand and the ring on her finger. The Würzburg Physico-Medical Society was the first to hear about these new X-rays, which could penetrate the body and photograph the bones. Mind you, this discovery was huge at that time. So on 28 December 1895, Roentgen gave his first preliminary report, uboein neuartstrahlin, to the president of Warburg Physical Medical Society, accompanied by his experimental radiographs and, of course, the famous image of his wife's hand. By New Year's Day, he had sent the printed report to physicist friends across Europe. Everybody now knew the word X-rays, and the world was gripped with X-ray mania. Roentgen was acclaimed as the discoverer of a medical miracle. W.C. Roentgen, who won the first Nobel Prize in Physics in 1901, declined to seek any benefits for his discovery, even eschewing the descriptions of his discovery and its applications. He used these tubes, the glass envelope tubes, known generically as Crookes tube, after the British investigator William Crookes. These were widely available during the period at which X-rays were discovered. This figure shows the different types of Crookes tube that were used by Roentgen in the period 1895 to 96 for the production of X-rays. This figure shows the Roentgen's apparatus for studying the ionization by X-rays in 1906. This was the famous image, the first X-ray made public, the X-ray of Roentgen's wife's hand with a ring on the ring finger. So now that we know about the history of X-rays, we will have a word about the electromagnetic spectrum. Electromagnetic spectrum, these radiations, is the transport of energy through space as a combination of electric and magnetic fields. The electromagnetic radiation is produced by a charge being accelerated. The familiar members of this family include the radio waves, the FM that we hear commonly, radiant heat, visible light, so important for existence, and of course, gamma radiation. The important members of this family also include, as you can see on the figure, the soft X-rays, the gamma rays, and the other X-rays. The diagnostic X-rays, this is a point to note, the diagnostic X-rays have a wavelength of 1 to 0.1 angstrom. Now, few lines about properties of X-rays. X-rays always travel in straight lines. They cannot be deflected by electric or magnetic field. X-rays have a high penetrating power, which we obviously know as they penetrate through X-ray films. Photographic film is blackened by X-rays. Fluorescent materials glow when X-rays are directed at them, which actually led to the discovery of X-rays. Ionization of a gas results when an X-ray beam is passed through it. Now we come to part two of this lecture, which is components of the X-ray tube. X-rays are produced by energy conversion. This happens when a fast-moving stream of electrons is suddenly decelerated in the target anode of an X-ray tube. This is a line diagram that depicts the basic X-ray tube. It shows a cathode arm, a cathode which is actually the source of electrons, the electron beam that is generated from the cathode and is highly accelerated towards the anode. This is the tungsten anode attached to the anode arm. The X-ray beam is the one that leaves the glass tube through the housing. Understanding X-ray tube a little more, X-rays can be generated by an X-ray tube, a vacuum tube, that uses high voltage to accelerate the electrons released by a hot cathode to a high velocity. These high velocity electrons then collide with a metal target, the anode, generating the X-rays. The medical X-ray tubes, the target used is usually tungsten or a more crack-resistant alloy of rhenium 5% and tungsten 95%. But sometimes there are more specialized applications like mammography, in which we are actually viewing thin structures like breast. At that time, we need low energy characteristic radiation, for which molybdenum is used as a target. This will be further explained in coming slides. Understanding further the X-rays production, the line diagram shows a common X-ray tube. Electrons from a hot cathode or filament are accelerated onto a target anode. Point to note that in this diagram, the anode has been shown in the form of a disc. So this is the example or the diagram of a rotating anode. When the electrons are suddenly decelerated on impact, some of the kinetic energy is converted into electromagnetic radiation as X-rays. The more the filament or the cathode is heated, that is, when we apply more MAs, more electrons will be produced. So the quantity of the X-rays can be increased. Then we come to the speed of the electrons. The speed of the electrons can be increased by increasing the voltage or applying more kVp to the X-ray tube. It is then that more penetrating X-rays are produced. So the quantity as well as quality of X-rays can be controlled by MAs and kVp respectively. This is a line diagram of X-ray tube and all its components. It very well shows the spiral tungsten filament or the cathode or negative terminal. It is attached to a high voltage supply so that when electrons are produced from the cathode, they can be accelerated through high voltage and target the anode. The anode is beveled. You can see this bevel. The anode is beveled. It is in a copper tungsten block. Copper is used for rapid heat dissipation so that the anode does not get overheated. This is the tube housing and the collimator. There is a window in the housing to allow the X-rays to move out of the tube. And all this is placed in a glass envelope. The X-ray tube, a diagram which I showed initially, the simplest form of an X-ray tube, it provides an environment for X-ray production. There are two processes taking place here, Bremsstrahlung and characteristic radiation mechanisms. The classical X-ray tube in the simplest form requires three things: electron source, electron acceleration, and target for X-ray production. I hope that this point is clear by now. Now, the basic model of X-ray tube uses a glass enclosure or a Pyrex glass. Why is this that we have to use vacuum inside a Pyrex glass? Vacuum is necessary because it seals the two electrodes together without the presence of gas molecules. If there were gas present inside the tube, the electrons that were being accelerated towards the anode, these would collide with the gas molecules, lose their energy, and also cause production of secondary electrons from gas molecules. Now, this energy loss and production of secondary electrons would cause a wide variation in the tube current as well as in the energy of X-rays produced. If there was wide variation, the tube current and the X-rays produced would not be well controlled. And this is the reason why vacuum is required to allow the number and speed of accelerated electrons to be controlled independently. The line diagram of X-ray tube. Now here, what is the difference from the previous line diagrams that we have already seen? Let's see the common things first. We have a cathode or filament or negative electrode. We have a sub-support for the cathode assembly. We have a beveled rotating disc anode and anode stem with a glass envelope. The difference here is that we have also depicted the rotating mechanism of the anode. What helps the anode to rotate so that every time that it is bombarded with electrons from the cathode, it is not the same area of the anode that is being involved. The anode keeps rotating and different parts of the anode are exposed to these electrons at different time. This highly increases the tube loading capacity as well as life expectancy. So that the diagram here differently depicts the rotor of induction motor and the stator of induction motor that helps to rotate this anode. A word about the negative terminal of the X-ray tube. The negative terminal of the X-ray tube is known as cathode. It is also called as filament because it is taken out into thin wires 0.2 mm in diameter and made into a filament of around 1 cm size. This is usually made of tungsten with atomic number of 74 and mass number of 184. The cathode actually is consisting of three parts. The first is the filament. The second are connecting wires. The connecting wires, their role is to supply voltage, approximately 10 volt, and amperage, approximately 3 milliamperes, 3 to 5, that heats the filament. Heating of the filament is actually the source of electrons from the cathode. The third part of the cathode is the focusing cup. This focusing cup is made of nickel, and it is negatively charged. So what is the importance of the focusing cup? Its work is that it converges the electron stream onto the target anode in the required size and shape. So the focusing cup, one, converges the stream, and two, also prevents the production of secondary electrons or any off-focus radiation. The tube requires electrical energy for two purposes. One, as I've already elaborated, is the heating of filament or cathode or negative terminal. This needs a small amount of current and voltage, so a step-down transformer is used. The current flow in this circuit is around 5 to 10 amperes and the voltage is 10 volt. The second use of electrical energy is for acceleration of electrons from cathode to the anode. For this, high energy is required. So a step-up transformer is used, and here the voltage varies between 40 to 150 kilovolt. Now, as we have already said, that cathode is commonly made of tungsten or an alloy of tungsten and rhenium. Why tungsten? This is a very common Viva question. Tungsten can be drawn into thin wires. It has a high melting point, around 3370 degrees centigrade. Tungsten has little tendency to vaporize. So there is very less tungsten deposition on the glass envelope. There is a reduced chances of arcing, and this leads to increased tube life. Also, tungsten has good absorption of heat and rapid dissipation as compared to other metals in the table. All these factors together lead to a long life expectancy of the tube and less production of off-focus radiation. Now, after we have understood about structure of cathode, we have to understand how electrons are produced at the cathode end. This process is known as thermionic emission. The emission of electrons resulting from absorption of thermal energy by a filament is called as thermionic emission. As already explained, the low voltage circuit is used to heat the filament. When the filament is heated, the orbital electrons gain enough energy to move a little away from the surface of the metal. This process is known as thermionic emission. And this electron cloud that surrounds the filament, this presence of electron cloud is known as Edison effect. The electron cloud itself, it is known as space charge. So what is space charge? Space charge is the electron cloud surrounding the filament due to thermionic emission. There is another effect known as space charge effect. When the electron cloud is surrounding the filament, it has a tendency to limit any further emission of electrons from the filament. This effect is known as space charge effect. So to understand the production of X-rays from the cathode, we have to know these four processes: thermionic emission, Edison effect, space charge, and space charge effect. After going through these processes, we go to an important part, which I have already elaborated, that vaporization of filament. Because the filament or the cathode is so many times repeatedly heated, it may lead to overheating, which was a drawback in the earlier days X-ray tube, because this shortened the life of the filament by making it thin and causing it to break. This can now be prevented by adding an automatic filament boosting circuit. The work of this circuit is that it keeps the filament at low temperature. Low temperature by a standby current in between the exposures, which is usually about 5 mA, so that in between exposures, the filament does not get overheated. Now that we have learned in detail about the cathode and the processes that cause production of electrons at the cathode, we come to anode angle and line focus principle. Now these two things are very much interconnected with each other. So one by one, I'll take you through this principle. First to understand is the focal spot. The focal spot is the area of tungsten target bombarded by electrons from the cathode. So as I had described the X-ray tube, now we have moved from cathode to the anode side. And we are talking about focal spot on the tungsten target or anode. Most of the energy is converted into heat, mostly when electrons are coming from cathode to anode, highly accelerated, maximum of their energy is converted to heat, and less than 1% actually forms the X-rays. So we need a large focal spot so that there should be adequate heat dissipation. And at the same time, we need a good radiographic detail. So a small focal spot is also required. How to solve this problem? This problem is solved with line focus principle. For this, the surface of the anode, which is facing the electron beam, is inclined to form an angle with the plane perpendicular to the incident beam. This angle is known as anode angle. I repeat, the surface of the anode facing the electron beam is inclined to form an angle with the plane perpendicular to the incident beam. This is known as the anode angle, and it is commonly 6 to 20 degrees. Because of this angulation, the focal spot, when viewed from the direction of emerging X-rays, the surface appears foreshortened, and this is known as the effective focal spot. The effective focal spot actually is much smaller than the actual focal spot. All this, which I explained in last two slides, will be elaborated with good diagrams in further slides. Now, this diagram explains the anode angle. We can see that there is an incident electron beam width in both these diagrams. This incident electron is bombarding the anode, which is inclined at an angle to the incident beam. This angle here is theta dash, and here is theta. We can very well see that theta dash is more than theta. So this beveling or inclination towards the surface perpendicular to the incident electron beam is known as the anode angle. The actual focal spot is the area on the anode that is bombarded by the accelerated electrons. So actual focal spot size is this, shown by this arrow. But when viewed from an angle from where X-rays are emerging, here the electrons are traveling from cathode to anode, highly accelerated, and here they leave the surface of the anode and the X-ray tube. So when we view from a surface from where the X-rays emerge, we can actually see that the focal spot size is appearing only this much, that is shown by the arrows. Actual focal size is this much, and effective focal spot size is this much, which is considerably less. So this is the line focus principle, which uses an anode angle to cause the small size of focal spot, which serves good radiographic detail, and a large focal spot size, which is the actual focal spot, so that there is adequate heat dissipation. Both these requirements of a modern X-ray tube is served with line focus principle. In the same diagram, we can see that as we decrease the anode angle, we can also decrease the focal spot size. So it means that if we need a good radiographic detail, we have to decrease the anode angle. But there is a limit to everything what we can do. So how much to decrease the anode angle? The decrease in anode angle is limited by Hill effect, which will be shown in further slides. The take-home message from this slide is, the smaller the angle, the better the resolution. Again, coming to line focus principle, because this is a very important concept to learn. The area of the X-ray tube anode from which X-ray production or X-ray photon are emitted is called the actual focal spot, whereas the projection, which is perpendicular to the central ray, which is the apparent area, is called the effective focal spot. Again, a diagram to show that as we decrease the anode angle, the effective focal spot size is reduced. Here is the actual focal spot on the beveled anode, and here is the effective focal spot. As we decrease the anode angle from 15 to 10 degrees, the effective focal spot size also decreases. Another diagram, easy to draw one, to show the same principle of line focus principle, and effective and actual focal spots. The unfortunate byproduct of the line focus principle is the anode heel effect. What is this effect? Anode heel effect is a construction phenomena that causes the X-ray photons exiting the tube on the cathode side to have a greater energy, while those which are exiting from the anode side have a lesser energy. Why does this happen? As we can see in this diagram, this is the beveled anode. This is the X-ray beam that is being produced. So here will be the cathode, which will cause production of electrons and acceleration of electrons to hit on the focal spot. This will be the cathode side of the X-ray beam produced, and this will be the anode side. As we can see the relative intensity, that the relative intensity of the X-ray beam increases from anode to cathode side. Why does this happen? This happens because there is a beam of anode which is beveled at an angle. So the heel of the anode actually functions to absorb some of the X-rays which are produced. That is why the anode side has a relative less intensity than the cathode side. The anode angle, which is generally from 6 to 20 degrees or 7 to 20 degrees, this causes variation of X-ray output in the plane comprising the anode-cathode axis. As I explained, it occurs due to absorption by anode of X number of photons which have a low emission angle. The magnitude of influence of this Heel effect on the image, it depends on three factors. The first is the anode angle. So as we go on decreasing the anode angle, the Heel effect will increase. So it's better not to decrease anode angle less than 7 degrees. Size of the film. The anode angle is much less appreciated in smaller films. If we have a larger film, 1714, the anode angle will definitely be much more appreciated. Next is focus to film distance. If the FFD is more, the anode heel effect is less appreciated than in shorter exposure distances. Also, anode aging increases the Heel effect. The Heel effect, although I have explained so much about it, but it is not always a negative factor. It can be used to compensate for different attenuation through different parts of the body. For example, thoracic spine, which is a thicker part of the patient, should be placed towards the cathode side of the tube. Also, in mammography, the chest wall part of the patient is placed towards the cathode side because it has a relatively high intensity of X-rays. Now that we have understood about line focus principle and anode angle, I would like to describe two types of anode. One is the stationary anode and second is the rotating anode. The stationary anode, as shown in this diagram, is a tungsten target embedded in a copper block. Why copper? Because it helps the conversion of heat energy, easy dissipation of the heat energy that is produced while production of X-rays. Why tungsten is used in anodes? Because it is an ideal target material. It has characteristic radiations of around 70 kilo electron volt, which is quite good for a binding energy of the electrons. It has a high atomic number, 74. It has a high melting point to withstand high temperatures, 3370 degrees centigrade. It has high thermal conductivity, so readily dissipates heat. and low vapor pressure at the working temperatures, so it does not disturb the vacuum. It effectively means that the vaporization is less of the tungsten target. Now we have to understand about the tungsten target in a copper block which makes up the anode. It is a good conductor of heat as already described. Heat is generated on the target by the beam of electrons. It is conducted along the cooling fins, radiated into the vacuum, and thereafter the oil bath, which absorbs the heat. This type of stationary anode X-ray tube is used in smaller portable X-ray machines. The heat output is limited by the amount of heat generated at the target. So, if overheating occurs, this would damage the anode. However, in modern machines, we use rotating anode, which is now explained. What is a rotating anode? As I had already explained in a line diagram in a previous slide, these are propeller fixed anode machines which have limited heat capacity. When larger machines are required, they need high area of target for bombardment of the electrodes from cathode to anode. This purpose for radiography as in chest and abdomen is served by a rotating anode. Tungsten target area is the beveled rim. This anode is a diameter disc of diameter 10 cm of size, and the anode angle as already described is 7 to 20 degrees. This disc rotates rapidly so that the electrons coming from the filament are striking a different area of the disc every time. This leads to increased heat capacity of the anode, decreased aging, and increased life expectancy. The rotation of the anode is caused by the rotator, which is shown in this diagram. The actual focal spot in a rotating anode is the complete circumference of the disc. So it is much greater than the stationary anode. The heat generated is spread over a much larger area. Therefore, larger exposures can be done while the effective focal spot is maintained at the same size. Now here, molybdenum rod is used to attach the anode to the rotator. Why? Because it is a poor conductor of heat, so it prevents the motor and the disc from overheating. The heat generated is lost by radiation through the vacuum and thereafter the glass envelope into the oil bath. The emerging X-ray beams have to be controlled by collimation for safety reasons. So till now, that was the second part of the lecture. We have learned about X-ray tube, cathode, anode, line focus principle, anode angle, and anode heel effect. Now we start, and here I would like to mention 2-3 slides about very important viva question. What is the difference between diagnostic X-ray tubes and the CT tubes that we use? This is a figure of a commonly used metallic Rolex CT tube. CTs require large continuous exposure times. Also, higher KV and MA is also required. So this means that for CT tubes should have heavy duty rotating anode, high thermal capacity, smaller focal spot for good radiographic details. They have to be air cooled. And a current up to 600 milliamperes is used in CT tubes. A line diagram about the common CT tube where we can see the cathode or filament, the rotating anode, the stator coils, the anode stem, and the rotator for the anode. All this is placed in a metal or ceramic housing. Why so? This will be explained in the next slide. So we have now a requirement in CT tubes of high heat generation, storage, and dissipation. There are some technical advances to deal with these requirements. The first was done in the anode assembly, in which we use a larger anode with graphite backing. Graphite is a very good insulator. Second is target design. The anode angle used is 7 to 10 degrees to decrease the Hill effect, not less than that. Third difference is in the cathode assembly. Cathode has a bigger filament size and increased effective focal spot. Fourth is in the tube envelope. Now, early CT tubes used borosilicate glass, which has good thermal and electrical insulation, but there was a problem. Electric arcing used to occur from tungsten deposits on glass caused by vaporization. Now, modern CT tubes have metal envelope with ceramic insulator. These tubes are more robust and have increased tube life. Why? Because they have a metal envelope. They are grounded, so there is no problem of arcing. There can be high tube loading with decreased off-focus radiation and at the same time allowing high tube current. So these are the four differences between the normal diagnostic X-ray tubes and the CT tubes. A very important Viva question. This is a figure showing the open gantry. Here is the X-ray tube and here are the detectors, and the X-ray beam is traveling. The patient is placed into the gantry. A word about mammography tubes. Mammography tubes usually use rotating anode. The difference, very important here, is mammography tubes use a different anode. It is made of molybdenum. Why? Because characteristic radiation of molybdenum peaks at 18 to 20 kilo electron volt, which is required to radiograph the thinner structures like breast. The filter here is rhodium or molybdenum filter. The tube window is usually made of beryllium. However, if there is thicker breast which has to be radiographed, then rhodium target with palladium filter is used with thin window made of glass. So when we are imaging with thicker breast, we deal with characteristic radiation of rhodium, which is around 24 electron volt. This is a diagrammatic tabular representation of difference between diagnostic mammography and CT tubes. Most of the points have already been explained in previous slides. So we go on to the next part of the lecture, which is phenomena of X-ray production. This is the last part of today's lecture. To understand the phenomena of X-ray production, we have to know the basics of structure of atom. The atom, as discovered, consists of a central nucleus, which is composed of particles known as nucleons. Nucleons comprise of protons and neutrons. Protons are positively charged and neutrons do not have any charge. So the nucleus of the atom is positively charged. There are electrons orbiting around the nucleus in orbits. These electrons are negatively charged. Atomic number of an atom is actually the protons in the atom. Atomic mass of an atom is protons plus neutrons. The electrons, as explained, keep orbiting around the positively charged nucleus. They have negative energy and they move around in shells which have been named as KLMNO, and further. These are spherical shells, and each shell has a fixed value of energy of its electrons. When some extra energy is given to the electron to raise its energy to zero so that it becomes free from the atom, this energy is known as binding energy. I repeat, the electrons have negative energy. When they are given energy from outside to raise its energy to zero so that it becomes free from the atom to move around, this energy is known as binding energy. The process of X-ray generation can occur whenever a high-speed electron targets an atom. There can be four processes that occur. Excitation of an outer orbit electron, ionization of an outer orbit electron, or ionization followed by emission of characteristic X-ray, that is known as characteristic radiation, and fourth, bremsstrahlung or breaking radiation production, that is general radiation. The first two do not contribute to production of X-rays. X-rays are produced only by process number 3 and 4, the bremsstrahlung or general radiation and the characteristic radiation. We will go over them one by one. Bremsstrahlung is the radiation given off by electrons as they are scattered by the strong electric field near the high proton nuclei. These X-rays have a continuous spectrum. The intensity of general radiation increases linearly with decreasing frequency from zero at the energy of incident electrons to maximum the voltage of the X-ray tube. The higher the atomic number of the target, greater will be the efficiency of production of X-rays by general radiation or bremsstrahlung. So now here we can understand the process of general radiation or breaking radiation by using this diagram. We have a central positively charged nucleus and we have electrons orbiting around it in shells, KLM. There is an incident electron which bombards the atom. It passes near the nucleus of the target atom. It is attracted by the nucleus, slows down, loses kinetic energy, and it is elastically scattered. Sometimes the electron hits the nucleus directly. This energy then is fully converted into X-rays. So when the electron is elastically scattered, it loses its kinetic energy. The kinetic energy lost is generated as bremsstrahlung or general radiation. Electrons, as we know, will undergo many reactions before coming to rest, and energy it loses with each reaction is small. So maximum radiation that is produced has little energy and appears as heat. Another diagram to understand general radiation, because this concept is very important for production of X-rays. This is the path of incident electron. It goes near the nucleus of the atom, gets attracted, slows down, loses its kinetic energy, and is deflected from its incident path. This loss of kinetic energy is converted into bremsstrahlung photon or general radiation. The more the filament is heated, that is when we use more MAs, more electrons are produced, and hence the quantity of X-rays can be increased. But if we increase the voltage and the speed of electrons, then more penetrating X-rays are produced. So both quantity and quality are controlled by MAs and KVP, and the general radiation can be controlled in this manner. The wavelength of X-rays is, as already described by general radiation, is a continuous spectrum. This variation is produced by different energies with which the electrons reach the target and by the fact that most electrons give up their energy in stages. The minimum wavelength of X-ray photon is dictated by the X-ray tube voltage or KVP. And the maximum wavelength or lowest energy X-rays escaping the tube will be dependent on the filtering action of the enclosure of X-ray tube, that is, on any added filtration. The next process that we need to understand is the characteristic radiation. Characteristic radiation results when the electrons bombarding the target eject electrons from the inner orbit of the target atom. So here we have an electron which is incident on the atom, highly accelerated. We have the atom with the nucleus and its electrons orbiting around in shells. This incident electron hits an inner orbit electron and causes it to eject from the atom. The loss of this inner orbit electron leads to a positively charged atom. Now, to make itself stable, electrons from higher shells, this is the K shell, so electrons from higher shells like L and M come inside to fill the vacancy that has been created by ejection of this electron. When the higher orbit electrons with higher energy come to a lower energy orbital shell, they give off X-ray radiation, which is known as characteristic radiation. This characteristic radiation is equal to the difference in binding energy of the K shell and the L shell of this atom. Another diagram, because characteristic radiation concept is very important to understand, so I repeat it with this diagram. We have an atom with a positively charged nucleus and its electrons orbiting in K, L and M shell. We have an incoming high energy electron which strikes the atom and removes an electron from inner orbit, that is the K orbit. The electron gets dislodged from the K shell. There is a vacancy created in the K shell. This vacancy leads to this atom becoming positively charged. To maintain the stability of the atom, the electrons from higher shells, that is L and M, jump in to fill this gap. When the higher energy electron from L shell jumps into K shell, this movement gives off an K alpha X-ray, this characteristic radiation, which is equal to the difference in binding energies of L shell electron and K shell electron. Similarly, K beta X-ray radiation is produced when there is a jump of electron from M shell to K shell. I hope the characteristic radiation process is clear now. In Bremsstrahlung, there is only a deflection of the incident incoming electron, whereas in characteristic radiation, this electron causes dislodgement of an inner orbit electron. The vacancy is filled by other electrons of the atom in the process producing characteristic radiation. Simply put, removal of an electron from a tungsten atom causes the atom to have an excess positive charge. The atom thus becomes a positive ion. In the process of returning to its normal state, the ionized atom of tungsten may get rid of excess energy in one of the two ways. It can either cause an additional electron called an auger electron to be expelled by the atom and carry this amount of excess energy, or there is an alternate way to get rid of excess energy, that is, The atom emits radiation that has wavelength within the characteristic X-ray range or the characteristic radiation. A point to note is that below 70 kVp, there is no characteristic radiation as K-shell energy itself is 70 kiloelectron volt. So the commonly operating voltages of any X-ray tube is more than 70 kVp. We have to use an optimum voltage, which is 80 to 150 kVp. Why? Because at this kVp, the characteristic radiation contributes about 10% to 28% of the useful X-ray beam. However, above 150 kVp, again the contribution of characteristic radiation drops and it becomes negligible above 300 kVp. Now this graph is a consolidated graph of Bremsstrahlung and characteristic radiation. On the x-axis is the generalized X-ray spectrum with the photon energies with kiloelectron volt. And on the y-axis we have relative number of photons per energy interval. We can see that Bremsstrahlung is a continuous spectrum of X-rays with a peak at the center more than 50 kVp, and in between this continuous spectrum is broken by K characteristic radiation spikes, which can be alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, which are maximum produced beyond the 70 kiloelectron volt margin. Now X-rays, if they are highly penetrating, it is called a hard beam. And if they are poorly penetrating, it is called a soft beam. Increasing the quality of X-ray beam is sometimes known as beam hardening. An X-ray beam is usually heterogeneous, that was described by the diagram earlier. This means that it contains X-ray photons with lots of different energies. There is a spectrum of energies. However, sometimes homogeneous or monochromatic or monoenergetic radiation is required when the beam contains photons which all have exactly the same energy. This can be reached by using filters. As photon energy increases, so the penetrating power also increases. A word about factors affecting the beam intensity and quality. We have understood about the X-ray tube, the cathode, acceleration of electrons across the cathode to anode, and the anode, all placed in a glass envelope. The tube output actually depends upon five factors: the tube kVp, the tube current, target material, filtration, and the distance. How does each affect the X-ray generation? This is what I'll tell in this last slide. Tube voltage or kVp determines the maximum energy of radiation produced and also the intensity. The amount of X-rays produced is proportional to square of kVp used. The tube current. The intensity of X-rays produced is directly proportional to the tube current or MAs. Next is the target material. The higher the atomic number of the target, more X-rays are produced. Also, the atomic number of the target determines the quality of X-rays. That is, the atomic number of target will determine at what point the characteristic radiation is produced and how much energy that characteristic radiation has. Filtration. As explained earlier, if we want a monochromatic beam, we can use filters to filter out the lower energy as well as higher energy X-rays. And last is the distance. As we move away from the X-ray tube, the intensity of X-rays decreases. So with this, I have come to the end of today's lecture dealing with electromagnetic spectrum and production of X-rays. I thank Dr. Satyen for making up radiology. I have authored a book, Radiology and Diagnostics. This is first of a 10 book series. It's a concept notes series. Quick reflections. I thank all of the participants who have listened to this lecture. A very big thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Eesha, on behalf of all the residents and the Prayas team. Such a difficult topic has been very comprehensively and very beautifully covered. We wish to have more lectures from you in the future. I would request any participant having any query can put their query in the chat box. Also, they can mail us at prayasradiology@.com. Thanks to everyone. Thanks, Dr. Eesha. We shall culminate the meeting now. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Satyen.